Hello and welcome to this week's episode of Talking Screen. I'm your host, John, better known as Dale around Yak Span. We have a fantastic show for you. World of Worlds server links and polls. The Mystic Forge gets a little more mystical. How the professions stack up in PvP post-patch, and much more. But first, let me introduce you to my fellow host. He is a moderator of MMO Champion. You know what my favorite staff skin is? In case if you don't, it's the Crossing. Mainly for the skeletal arm that's holding a Green Lantern. Eh? Say hello to Jim.
I was a little tortured, but I'll give you a point for that one.
It became harder as I looked at your face. You're like, really? Really? You're doing this one? Really? I couldn't resist. He writes over on his blog, agegaming.wordpress.com, where he answers the age-old question, do you think my concept for Thief Warhorn is amazing or awesome? Say hello to Age.
It's neither one. I'm hiding my head because of the shame of that pun. I'm sorry, guys.
Just honestly, though, Thief Warhorn would be really cool if you'd like call in other like thieves to come in and do like strikes and stuff.
I was thinking, it would be all centered around stunning, because just imagine something stealthy coming up and blowing a horn in your face. You'd be like, nah.
Sure.
So there you go. One free one arena net. There you go. Thief Warhorn. Next one. The elite specialization would be called the Pest.
Please don't.
But let's jump right into it. Last week we started talking about the World v World linking. And now that we missed a week and a half because we had to change scheduling, we had the first week and the actual it actually changed hands again. So basically, if you don't know, World v World went under the best way you can not call it a server merger, but it basically they paired high-tier World of Worlds servers with low-tier World of Worlds servers, and basically they became a new team, and it was just the same World of Worlds, just with a new population. It was meant to help the lower servers that were really hurting on a population. But, yeah, I think the rundown, I mean, should we go through every single one of the team-ups, or should we just kind of...
take forever.
Yeah, I was going to say, basically we'll do like the top tier ones. Like originally the top tier were Yaxben, Black Ain, Jade Quarry. Well, Yaxben got teamed up with Anvil Rock, Black Ain got teamed up with Aerodon Terrace, and Jade Quarry got teamed up with Aojanthir, and it kind of went so on and so forth. It seemed like they matched, you know, the top with the bottom and then worked their way into the middle. And same with...
Apparently, Jade Quarry is now out, and Dragonbrand and... Sanctum of Rawl is in now.
Yeah, that actually changed hands this past Friday. Jade Quarry has been bumped down to tier 2. So, I mean, overall, how do you guys feel about this server, or the World of your World linking, and did the populations feel stronger, stuff like that?
I will say that there is definitely an increase in activity, as in there are a lot more people. There's a lot more skirmishes in a bunch of places. Is it better overall? I wouldn't necessarily say in the long run, because it's just this allows for more people to participate in World versus World. It makes it feel more alive. There's more things to do. But this is a good start to everything.
Yeah, I was going to say, that is the important thing to note, that they did say this isn't the only thing they're doing to address server population. This is just the start of things, so hopefully it goes further. But it looks like you were going to say something, Jim?
It's probably the only real way they have to do this, to give the lower tier servers, the servers that don't really have a high population, a chance to actually play large scale, more organized dub-v-dub, because how else are you going to organize? Are you going to, you know, make red, blue, green guilds that could be your like sixth guild and you join a guild? Well, what if, you know, the populations get imbalanced? They have to start locking out, you know, different dub-v-dub guilds, and then, you know, you might not be able to play with your friends there. Or, you know, do they start assigning players at random to a team? Well, then you can't actually play with your friends in dub-v-dub because your entire guild could be split up three ways. So this is really the only solid way they have to keep people playing together without just kind of leaving the lower tier servers in the dust. Mm-hmm. Though I will say, they might have to up the player cap on the dub-v-dub maps with this, just in case more people get
it. Yeah, because, I mean, the queues were insane, at least the first night, but that's kind of expected because it was like, hey, something new is going to happen.
Right.
People wanted to...
But mechanically, I mean, now you've got, technically, for every Borderland, there is six servers worth of people that could log into it. So they might have to bump up the population limits.
Well, not necessarily. I mean, if you look right now, it's just the Borderlands don't have a queue, and there's a 68-person queue for Eternal Battlegrounds. So.
Well, how much of that is people still not liking the desert Borderlands? I mean,
I don't know. I find that a lot better than before.
Yeah, but also this is the internet, and the internet doesn't like change.
Is a change for the better, but I don't know how many people like it per se.
Well, it's one of those things where it's like, I hated it when it came out. How could they possibly fix it? There's nothing they can do. People get this deep-seated hatred of something. It's like, I hated that when it came out. How could they possibly make it any better? How can I possibly like this? So even if changes come out, I didn't like Mesmer when I first leveled mine. I like it now, because there have been some changes made, but there are people who are, I don't know, less willing to go back and look at stuff.
I will honestly say now, I think it's more of a map is too big issue, so that if you die, go all the way at the start. It's kind of like Snake and Ladders.
I mean, I think it might come down to like the World v. World player is, do you see it as it's such a far run to get back to maybe where you were or to the next objective, or if you address what Jim is saying, have more people on the map, you could run into people to fight a lot faster potentially. I mean, it depends on how you're like looking at World v. World. Like, you want to just kind of go out there and find someone to pick off maybe while you're adventuring towards your objective, or
I honestly feel like if the Borderlands were as populated as Eternal Battlegrounds, it would feel like that a lot. Like that already. Because in Eternal Battlegrounds, you can usually find a fight within, even if you die, come back, you can usually find someone who's doing something, and then you have to go kill them because they're being annoying.
Like a warrior with a great sword critting you for over 4K?
I'm not going to speak of that. Things like that.
Nerve.
It was actually a double hit. I don't know if you saw that.
It was a double hit, yeah.
They caught you with the very end of the...
He crit twice for 4K. That's not cool.
But
you're
I mean,
feet, you're squishy. Deal with it.
Though, as we were talking about how between this week and last week, how Jade Quarry got bumped down to Tier 2, I know a lot of people, and they were talking about last week, were throwing around the term, and I hope I'm saying this right, Glicko? Like...
Glicko.
What in the world is Glicko? Like, can anyone explain it to me?
Is it an acronym? I can't remember off the top of my head.
It's just a rating system to measure skill.
The Glicko rating system and Glicko 2 rating system are methods for assessing a player's strength in games of skill.
Huh. So it does it on a server base.
Mm-hmm. Invented by Mark Glickman as an improvement on the ELO rating system.
Hmm. Yeah, wow, so wait, PvP, doesn't PvP use the ELO system? World v. World uses the Glicko. Wow, how many other,
It could be that Glicko, that was just, you know, a really quick definition. It could be that Glicko is better for large-scale stuff, and Elo is better for individually assessing. Because in PvP, you have a personal Elo system.
Yeah.
Glicko, this is applied to the server as a whole, so it's possible that this is a much larger scale system, and that's just the difference between...
Well, I mean, for me, I think this is maybe one of the problems with the linking worlds, because, you know, in an individual server basis, Jade Quarry held steady at, you know, in tier 1 and 3rd place. Granted, we haven't had any tournaments to challenge that as of lately, but, you know, with that system, it's, you know, the worlds that win, especially by a large margin, will have their rating increased by a larger amount, but also the reverse of worlds that lose, especially by a large margin, will have their rating decreased. So, do you think the linking kind of, like, linking with the lower tier server threw them into the tier 2?
I don't necessarily think so, just because for the past couple of months, you know, servers haven't really been trying. And so I think jQuery, for the most part, have not been trying the most out of the three, as far as I've seen. So it may have been their rating was a little low already. And so with the addition of this change to the system, it may have just been enough to drop them down.
Also, it's possible that the Dragon Brand and Sanctum Overall, they could have just done that well, and they swung up really hard. So they might only be a few points ahead of Isle of Janthir, or jQuery, my bad. Yeah, they might be just like a few points ahead, and it's just with the increased volatility of the system. Don't you start, Eugene.
Yeah, I know age has gone into World v. World. I've tried to. It's just between queues and just real life, I think I've gone in like for maybe two sessions of an hour each. Like, I haven't really... And that's not a lot of time to do much of anything. But how do you feel that the linking has gone with the game itself?
I think people care more, to be honest. I mean, in the past couple months, Stonemist was on a rotation of whoever had it. But every time I've gone in this week, it's always Blackgate that always had it. And that's really impressive. And they've always defended it. And I'm like, well, looks like we're trying this week. And, yeah, so.
I do remember you said that. I think that was Thursday's stream. You were talking about that. It's like, wow, we still have this.
Yeah, because usually it's just rotation. Yaxman would have it. jQuery would maybe have it at some point. But, yeah, that's kind of cool. I think it just promotes more incentive to actually play and to a lot more activity. So,
it's really good stuff. I think the biggest question is how soon do they have to capitalize on this to make it worth it? Because, I mean, if it kind of just sits there with this in there, it's going to have people start being like, well, it's just the same thing. Because it is important to keep in mind that, you know, this is a beta system. So they can change it, you know, they could potentially scrap it. They could improve on it. But do you think how soon do they have to put in like the next system to keep people in there?
It's 2 weeks. I think they should add something to World vs. World. Anything.
Well, so if just... the WDub team is moving on to iterative design like the narrative team was doing for Living Story, then yeah, every 2 weeks would be a really good dev cycle. Even if it's something small, just something new would help keep people in.
Yeah, and I would say it's been 2 weeks now, almost. Oh, no, it's been a week.
It's a week and a half or so.
Yeah, so I would say in the next week and a half, 2 weeks, have something significant come in and see how that does. Put that in beta phase, or what have you.
Yeah, and I would even think, like you said, maybe smaller things would probably be nicer, since these are beta projects. Like, you don't want to be like, here's this whole system, and it's like, well, you know, it's just not working. They'd have to look at each individual piece. So hopefully they do add like little things that, you know, they're potentially working on, or at least news about, hey, it's coming in a week, or, you know. But yeah, that's my one worry, is if they are idle with it too long, that it's just gonna have people go, well, it's just more of the same. Like,
yeah, I can understand that. Yeah,
but you know, we're talking about potentially what's coming down the road. Well, they kind of gave us a little bit of insight. This week, they actually put up a War of the World poll, and it opened up on the 28th, and it will be going to May 4th. And there are three options: War of the World quality of life improvements, War of the World scoring improvements, and no preference. So I think it's important to note the quality of life. They have underneath of it as like little like bullet points of what they're probably going to do with it. Add an option for reduce nameplate clutter, add cross map team chat, add objective summary tooltips, add a display effect for righteous indignation on map markers, add floating indicators when gaining points toward war score, add a world XP gain sparkle trail, add a territory control map overlay, and also take suggestions from the community. And on the side of scoring, they want to look at reducing the impact of night capping, lessening the gap between winning scores and losing scores, so losing teams can still recover, adjust objective score relative to upgrade level, adjust score for capturing objectives, rebalance the score awarded for activities that don't reward points per tick, and also take suggestions from the community. I'm curious, and if you don't want to answer it, I perfectly understand. But oh, and of course, the third option, no preference. You don't have a preference. If you don't want to answer, we're going, you know, slightly political. It's your right to keep it to yourself, you know. Would you guys want to talk about maybe what one you're leaning towards, or?
I voted scoring.
I'm not sure. Gate. I don't care if people scoring. Know.
Yeah.
I mean, the cross-map team chat and the righteous indignation is a great thing, but the rest are simply just quality of life stuff, just from my perspective. The scoring has a lot more impact on how War vs. World is played, and it would be better to have that out first.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because, I mean, I know for me, and, like, I think we've talked about it in the past, where it's like scoring, that's kind of the foundation for War of the World. Not the foundation, but one of them. And if you don't have that, you're adding the quality of life. You're building like structure, like the walls for it, but you're building it on a foundation that can't support it. Like, you're building it on a dirt foundation. If you hopefully improve scoring for the better with what you're going to attempt, you have a stronger foundation to build these quality of life things on. But I do know a lot of people gravitated towards quality of life, and you have to log in to do this, and you only get one vote. So, you know, make it count.
And I kind of agree with Arlie in chat that people voting on QOL wrong.
I think a lot of people are hoping for, because trust me, it was like one of the first things that was said in, like, I saw Reddit comments, and on, they have a forum going where you can discuss it as well in their official forums. The first thing that came up was build templates. And I was like, well, why are people immediately jumping to that? And I do have to thank, because I was talking about it on Twitter, and thankfully, Dragon Season and MMO Inks actually showed me the Reddit AMA with the devs during the spring update. So it wasn't like the one at the beginning when Colin was leaving. This one was literally last week. And Mike O'Brien actually says, you know, starting with this release, which is the spring update, The World Over World team is switching over to live development, shipping frequently, beta testing on the live service, you know, all the stuff we've been seeing. And they say how the World Over World team will be at the forefront of this. If it goes well, they'll consider for PvP. He brings this up in particular because development of build templates would happen on one of those two teams. So I expect that you collectively will be in control of when that becomes a priority. Is, like, I think a lot of people are saying, is this our moment? Are we going to miss our moment if we don't pick quality of life? I think that's the worry.
I don't understand why templates need to come from PvP or WW.
I think it's probably because I know at least PvP, that's probably the easiest in the sense of less variables.
It's easier to develop it, yeah, because there's less stuff to handle, but I don't understand the line of thought where it's just like, it's not so much like there are less variables to handle, but it's not like you're picking out a ton of stuff. It's like, it's this piece of equipment goes here. If you do not have this piece of equipment, then it's like, hey, you're missing something. It's just a few more lines of that. It's just a little more busy work at that point. That's me guessing. I don't know how their back end looks, but
it's a little more involved with that because, you know, PvP, I would honestly say I would start with PvP just because it's a little simplified version of it, because you only have to work with an amulet, one rune, and everything like that. With World versus World, which would pretty much simulate PvE anyway, you have to worry about different rune setups, sigils that are allowed, which is pretty much everything except for PvP. The differences in those PvP runes and sigils and things like that, you have infusions to worry about, and then you have exotics, ascended, legendary.
Well, that kind of stuff is like you've put that in a piece of gear. Like, I don't think that you're going to be doing a build template that lets you select the things you put into your gear. It's just like you have, like, for my elementalist, I have my armor is assassin with eagle runes. I have a few weapons that I use. I have my trinkets, and then I have my, honestly, I think people really just want templates for their
I'm worried that that's choices, the driving force.
But
it is important to note, if you're just tuning in or you're hearing the keyword build templates and you're focused now, that's not promised in that list. That would fall under the, we'll get community feedback and like suggestions from the community. But if you look here, we grabbed, this is the actual results after you pick your choice.
As of right now, anyway.
Yeah, and this was probably like 30 minutes ago, but it's roughly right around there. But as you can see, 49.1% of World of World scoring improvements, 45% for World of World quality of life improvements, and 5.9% for no preference. So, it's close.
And before, like, going off template, just for scoring, the reason I voted scoring, I really think that scoring needs to be on a much smaller time frame. I really do, because as of right now, my experience with WW is getting to the commander tag, following the Zerg around, and flipping camps so that Righteous Indignation stays up during the tick.
Mm-hmm.
Which is boring. Really boring.
And I agree with chat, like, why would you vote for no preference? I think they added in there just so they have all the bases covered, but also, I'm guessing someone goes along there and just goes, well, I don't War of the World.
I don't care.
And possibly don't think about, like, because, you know, it's not readily right there, but like we said before, if it would involve build templates, it could stem out to PvE and PvP. So it could affect a PvE-only player, but, yeah, it's not going to... It might not instantly hit someone.
And Carnifex, I know I was just thinking that. If you don't care, don't vote. But it would literally, like, I can hear the people on the internet screaming, like, why don't I get a voice in this? And it's like, you don't play WW. I don't care. I want to click a button.
That is another good point, yes.
It's more like, I don't care. Either one will be fine for me.
There's also that too. So if you would rather have, if the lists sound good either way, that's what no preference is for, and it's also there as a placebo. So
yeah, it's just like, I'm just happy to be here. Keep doing what you're doing, kind of a mentality type thing, if you want to go that route. Yeah, so yeah, I personally voted for World v. World scoring. Like I said, I'm a little worried that, and while I was focusing on how the list said, you know, we'll take suggestions from the community, I saw that in the quality of life. I remember Jim right before the show was like, well, it hasn't in both. But scoring is such a more definitive subject to focus on than quality of life, because you could kind of say some things in scoring could probably go under quality of life. So just to say, like, it seems more of a catch-all for the quality of life than the scoring is.
Could we just pick one, and then the suggestions could be the other one? That way we could just get both.
That would be evil, and I could see the internet doing that.
I don't know if that would actually work.
But they said take suggestions from the community. That's a suggestion.
I know, but I don't know if that would work. Because
one person has to do it, and what if they're like, we're going to listen to that person. They are the hero.
Yeah. It's like, joke's on you. We're going to do both anyway.
I mean, they by the sounds of it, they're probably going to eventually try to do both. It's just what they're going to try to, you know, get out first, which I think for the longevity of World v. World, it would have to be scoring. I mean,
I prefer scoring. Quality of life is more like something that is nice to have, but is not completely necessary at the moment. Whether, on the other hand, scoring is pretty much vital to how World vs. World works.
Yeah, I mean, let's say this is the next thing that is coming. Like we said before, they need to capitalize on these influx of people coming in. If we look at the list of quality of life compared to scoring, what, for me, it's like, what would keep the player in? Like, quality of life, add an option for reduced nameplate clutter. That's nice, but is that going to be like, this makes me more interested in World v. World? I wouldn't be. Like
that sounds
add
like
cross-map team chat?
Period.
Yeah, add cross-map team chat. That is definitely nice, because, yeah, you can coordinate, yep. But a lot of World v. World servers tend to use a voiceover system, so they kind of have a workaround for that.
Yeah.
Like, add objective summary tools. Like, as I'm going through that list of quality of life, and of course, because it's quality of life, it's like, yeah, that would be nice to have, but like scoring, like reducing the impact of night capping, lessening the gap between winning scores and losing scores so losing teams can still recover, that keeps people in the game, involved in, like Chad's saying, yeah, scoring is more important, but
people keep saying night capping, and I just like, I had my rant in ages, Chad.
I could talk about it again if you want, but go ahead.
Well, I've said it before on the show, is that WW is war. It is a war simulation. And if there is a time when your enemy has less forces deployed in an area, you capitalize on that weakness. That's what you're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
So I get night capping sucks because you just don't have the people to defend objectives.
Yeah, and the point,
what the hell are you going to do about it?
And the point I brought up is that you have different regions playing on a server. So, for example, NA, if you're playing on an NA server, you may have some EU people, you may have some Australian people, and they can help you in assist, and that's kind of the cause of the night capping issue. That's, so if one server has all these different regions playing for them and they can provide that support during the time where NA residents are sleeping, then you have a clear advantage. Whether as in like actual war, everyone's supposed to be there. So if your resources are actually applied in one faculty or another, that's why.
Well, I mean, that's the same thing. It's like you've got forces in a war that, you know, you deploy them out and then they have to come back. because you can't just keep them in the field. You have to rotate them out. So that's kind of like the wave thing of it's just going to happen. And I mean, I think one of the other things I talked about is, you know, you can region lock stuff, not give people the opportunity, the option to go to another server. But one, that would be trying to put the cat back in the bag, which isn't something that's going to be easy to do or popular or even something that they should do. But and then there's IP locking. But, you know, people can get around that. It would definitely reduce the number of people that are outside of the zone because it increases the technical knowledge necessary so that you could VPN or tunnel to another region in the world and go from there. But that would greatly reduce the number of people because how many people are technical enough, one, to know how to do that, two, to take the time to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, it's going to be something that you deal with. Like, shit, that's what they had to do in, like, the old Alterac Valley stuff in Vanilla Warcraft. When matches would last a week, you'd actually have to set up rotations of people and figure out, you know, who can cover what to take care of the back and forth of it. So, WV always struck me as something that's a little more cerebral in the planning phase, rather than just, you know, a Zerg blobbing around taking objectives. So I can't say that I see nightcapping as such a huge deal. So
that's and just kind of to go back to the comment in chat about, yeah, scoring is more important, but they need to put reward with scoring too. My only problem, like, I honestly, like we said before, I think they're going to have to put these in smaller bites. Like, I think rewards, unfortunately, but hopefully will be this, will be one of the last things, because you don't want to do, like, okay, we made the scoring system, and here's these rewards. Oh, well, we had, because of this new feature we put in, we have to tweak scoring a little bit, and now everybody's getting legendaries for just walking into a place. Like,
there
they don't
are rewards
put back.
For scoring. Like, if you hit B and you look at the details tab, you get bonuses to harvesting, crafting, XP, gold gain, karma gain, stuff like that. Honestly, you want to put in a reward for winning a match, you get bonuses on your WW track.
That would be nice.
There you go. Like, first place of your matchup gets a decent chunk, second place gets a smaller chunk, third place gets a smaller chunk.
That's a decent way.
You have a definitive convert to resources reward for your world winning a match.
Now, do you know, like, those bonus chests that you usually get at the beginning and usually run out, like, when you level up, when you rank up or level up in World v. World? Is that, like, a better chance to get materials, or is that just another chance to get, like, the same materials you would get as a ranked
chest? Another chance. I haven't gotten any bonus chests in a while, but I'm pretty sure it's just another chance.
Well, I was going to say, what if they added us, like, for winning, you actually got another of those chests, but now that you're saying it's just another chance, I wasn't sure if it was, like, a different pull with a different... Like, maybe to give them another shot at getting maybe an ascended weapon or ascended armor, but not a guaranteed, because you don't, like... Then everybody will just be in there and...
Yeah, it probably amount to pretty much the same thing. I would... It's not you get something extra, it's just another bonus chest where you have a chance to get stuff.
Because, yeah, I would like to see stuff like that to make it enticing to be like, I want to win that. Like, I want to be in first because I want shiny, fun stuff.
And that's what the tournaments should be about when they start back up again.
When they come back, yeah.
Well, the tournaments are for shinier, funner stuff, I guess you could say. But there's still going to be a lull, like an in-between. There's got to be something for the in-between to keep people more invested in WV for wanting to actually care about it.
And that's for a shinier prestige skin. Whereas, like I said, if it gives you a chance at getting these ascended, it's now making your character better because, you know, a lot of people are like, you can't run exotics in World v. World. Look, my dogs are outraged.
Ah. Well, yeah, I do agree that some rewards for end of the matchup would be very nice. And especially, and I think the reward track would actually be really good because I would say do it for people who actually participate in World vs. World, not just because you're on the server.
Yeah. I agree with that. It's like you have participated in... Okay, so example is, you know, for first place, second place, and third place, there is a set amount of progress, like, mm-hmm. that is the maximum. And then based on your participation in WW that week, you know, if you only participate in a little bit, you get this percentage chunk of what your world won. Okay. So that somebody who hopped in for, like, 2 hours one day would get less than somebody who has been in 2 hours for one day on the winning server would probably get less than someone who was playing all week on the third place server.
Okay. That's
so fun. It rewards the people that are there all the time with the most rewards that they can get.
That sounds pretty fair, if you did it that way.
It's just, I was gonna say, what if there was a meta World v. World meta tier system? Like, you do World v. World dailies, so like X amount of days out of the week or something.
I wouldn't do the based on dailies either, just because you can
dailies easily knock those out. Yeah, the dailies can be easy to get.
I would do it based on the hours you actually spend in World versus World.
Also, there would probably have to be like a hard threshold of, you know, you have to spend X out, like, once you get past X hours, you are guaranteed the whole chunk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, like, if you've spent, 10 hours in WW over the course of a week, you get 100% of your server's rewards.
Yeah, some sort of threshold. Yeah, that sounds fun.
Yeah. Yeah, if that's full, I would say that's a good balance of, because that would be 2 hours a night for 5 days. Like, I'd love to hear people's ideas of, like, if you like that concept, like, how many hours do you think? Please don't say, what's 24 times 7? Don't say that number. Like, anyway. Any other thoughts of the World v. World poll? I mean, we talked about in the past. This is, like, the most direct way, like we used to say, like, they're watching the forums. This is, like, they're literally asking everybody, so go make your voice heard.
This is something, and I know we talked about it with Arlie before she left, is that doing content based on community feedback is a dangerous road.
Yeah.
Because... I know, you know, there's the phrase, the customer is always right. Well, the customer is frequently wrong and stupid. I'm not saying that of any individual person, but I'm sure everybody here that has ever worked a service job or in the service industry at large has had that one customer who says the customer is always right, and you kind of want to slap them for it because they're just doing something utterly, ridiculously stupid. That's one of the things...
But
that's the one thing I worry about is that, and I this is something that Arlie said too, it's worrying that if, say, someone spins an idea in such a way that it would actually be terrible, but it's said in such a way that it, like, the community kind of jumps on it and it kind of spins out of control, and it's like, well, this is what you guys wanted, so here you go. And then people start complaining about it. It's like, you wanted it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The catch-all from the suggestion community, like you guys said, it might prove to be an issue in that regard. But we shall see.
Yeah, especially on such a vague subject as quality of life. Like, scoring, you can still say, well, that's not really in the bounds of scoring. That's getting into, like, you know, if I was one of the devs and, like, the comment said about putting rewards, I'd be like, well, that's more, we're going to look more towards that during the reward system, but, you know, we might possibly try to throw a little bit of rewards in there so you guys are willing to play and try the content.
See, my only thing about QOL is, like, that is literally no major systems change. When you say quality of life to a developer, that is, like,
nice to have.
Like, it's something that's nice, but, yeah, it's not something you really want to jump on. It's secondary at best, tertiary and farther at worst. So, quality of life still has it's more vague than scoring, but it still has a window.
Yeah. It's like a donut with frosting on it, and the sprinkles are like extra.
The sprinkles are quality of life.
Yeah.
See, Bethesda understands.
Guild Wars 2 is a donut.
With icing.
With icing.
What's that?
Thank you, Bayorn. They specifically note what are the categories that fall within QOL. There's going to be a second survey on which categories are going to be developed.
Okay.
So there is a survey after the survey.
Oh.
Oh, so apparently build templates are one of the ones listed in there.
Okay.
Build templates are QOL.
Yes, so. and it's nice. Trust me, I want build templates. But
they feel necessary at this point with the stuff I do.
But yeah, I would love to... Yeah, surveyception. That's how I feel. You know what? I'm lazy, so I'm going with scoring. I only want to do one survey. I don't want to be like... Oh, well, congratulations on winning that survey. Here's another survey. Like,
I want scoring with build templates. Thank you.
Score templates?
Scoring with build templates. There we go. And registering indignation map thing, if you could fit that in. That'd be awesome.
Yeah, and chat's also saying, you know, it was a feature they had in Guild Wars 1. But while it's on the same engine, it is two different games, and, you know, it... Coding can be fun. Let's just leave it. They're both going to have two surveys. Oh, man. I can't be lazy and just pick scoring? Darn.
Nope, you get the survey section.
We'll check next week.
There's a title, Surveyception. We shall see. You know, go, you know, get your voice heard. Like I said, you have to log in. You only get one vote. I think if you log in for the second time, it just shows your original post. So you can switch it if you change your mind. It does close May 4th. So get on that quickly.
May the 4th be with you.
Yeah.
Moving on.
Interestingly enough, in the world of PvE and skins... Returning items in the Mystic Forge. So, ever since the Spring Quarterly, people have noticed with the Ghastly Grinning Shield, which, if you don't know, is first Halloween, and it came back, I think, the second Halloween for kind of random, like, it was a lot harder to obtain, let's just say. It was very RNG lottery system. I remember talking about it and arguing about it. With Roy. He's still wrong about that. but basically it was a kind of a black, like misty smoke coming off your back as a shield, which, with like an almost red eyes and mouth, like jack-o'-lantern type thing. Looks pretty cool. People have been noticing because it's been sought after. While it's even just a skin, it didn't have stats. It would be selling for like 3,000 gold, like the price of like legendaries. That's how sought after this skin was. Well, people started noticing it was falling. Seemed like it was falling before the patch, but it greatly plummeted once the spring update came out. Well, we did get information that apparently people were getting these out of the Mystic Forge, which it's like, is this a bug? Should I, you know, people were like, is this a bug? Hence, should I cash in now before you change it? Like, you know, those types of things. And they looked into it, and they actually found out that was supposed to be a part of a bigger update to the Mystic Forge, which wasn't quite ready for the patch. So they pulled most of the changes, as well as the release notes. However, since this change did not go into the build, they did want to let everybody know about it. So... basically you are able to put in rare weapons, and they specifically say rare weapons, so I don't know if exotics work. I don't think there's been proof of it. They only say rare weapons, and you can get They listed the Bloodbound weapons, Aetherized weapons, Shadow of the Mad King weapons, and, as they said, orphaned skins from Living World Season 1. So, the interesting thing is, what weapons do you think will return?
When you said orphan weapons from Living World Season 1, you mentioned the fused weapons, and I have a fused shortbow skin.
Yeah, I'm definitely curious from that perspective, for because I know a lot of people, if like, will come out and say, like, especially those items, because it doesn't list the fused weapons, but that could definitely be one of them. Because it is one from Living World Season 1 that they necessarily didn't list, but it could be a strong likelihood, I would feel. But for people that don't know, the fused weapons were very hard to obtain. They still might be on the trading post for, like, hundreds of gold, if not, over 1,000. But, yeah, they basically looked almost, like, just had, like, flame effects coming off of them. They look really nice, if that's the style you're going for.
Yeah, it's kind of like molten lava with a bit of flame coming off. I personally wouldn't mind if my short bow would become one of the options, just because it's been, like, what, 3 years now since I've had the bow. I've only used the few short bow skin because it's, one, over 2K, and two, it's one of the only short bow skins I like. Until I make Chuka and Chumwa, then that's going to be my skin of choice. But I personally wouldn't mind it. I know some people may have other opinions about that, but me personally, I wouldn't mind, because it's been a while. I've had the prestige of it. For the Ghastly Grinning Shield, I'd noticed it went down to, like, 420 gold, and...
Yeah, I think once they announced it, I saw it go as low as, like, 230 or 2, like...
Yeah, I've seen it go down to 250.
It plummeted.
It went down quite a lot, and I think it went up back a bit, because some people realized it'll still be a little harder to get, but it makes it so that these are more accessible. I think people who had these on the trading post weren't actually selling these weapons, maybe. I don't know why they made the change exactly. I don't know if they wanted to make it more accessible and they realized that some of the ones that were on the trading post weren't just selling, or what, but I can get a ghastly getting shield if I want, I guess. So.
Yeah, I would say that's kind of the stuff that I was looking after. Was love to get the Ghastly Grinning Shield. Probably the chain greatsword. Don't know who I'd use it on, but I just want it.
Yeah. I feel like that might be 2 years. Who would get that? Like 2 Halloweens ago? So maybe next year or the year after, it'll become more readily available. Never know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just happy they're putting a lot of the stuff back in the game. It's a good strategy, and the Mystic Forge, just having it randomly lottery a lot of this stuff. And I know your feelings about lottery stuff, Deo. But,
I don't mind the Mystic Forge. I mean, yeah, for people who don't know, the Mystic Forge is, well, basically in Lion's Arch. You can get in, like, PvP. Well, I don't think PvP anymore. World v. World, and, like, if you have any of those, like, airship passes that take you to the special areas. But, basically, this is kind of like, lore-wise, it's a Jin Zomaros that supposedly came from Alona, and is basically in this device and rewards you with stuff if you put certain items into it, blah, blah, blah. Basically, what it is... You know, they can throw items in. Now, there are certain recipes that if you throw certain items in, and it can only be up to 4 things, like if it's a certain 4 items, there's recipes that it will always work. It'll always result in that. But it's also a way to kind of gamble items. Like we said, if you throw in 4 rare weapons, you usually get a rare weapon back or a chance at an exotic, which is the next tier up. And it kind of works through like that through all the tiers except for getting to Ascended and Legendary. That would be insane. But it's also a way to get precursors and stuff like that of the original precursors.
You can throw a couple legendaries and then get legendaries.
Well, you can throw in two legendaries. You can actually get Eternity, but yeah, I wouldn't recommend that. But yeah, basically the Mystic Forge is kind of like a gamble. I mean, there's a reason why a lot of people refer to it as the Mystic Toilet. You tend to flush your rewards down there.
You just kind of throw stuff in.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would love to see the stats.
Currency extractor, that is a great way to put it, Trick.
Currency extractor.
That's you're not wrong. Like it is, it's a sink. It takes stuff out of the economy actively, and people do it willingly. I have gotten two of the three precursors that I actually four. No, I've gotten three of the four precursors I've gotten out of the Mystic Forge.
Precursors have you gotten?
I had, I have Frostfang, and I bound that, and I'm going to make, that one. And then I got the Lover, and I got the, what's the precursor for?
Kutsu or Flameseeker?
Flameseeker.
The Chosen.
Yeah, I got the precursor. Yeah, the Chosen. I got the Chosen, the Lover, and, I think I had one more. But I sold those three so that I could buy the Leaf of Kudzu for my wife. And then I got Frostfang off the drop.
Actually, I was going to rage and say how you got four, but I was kind of like, I actually got three. So, moving on quickly. Because now the internet probably hates us. Granted,
bottle mine.
Granted, feel bad for me. I sold two of them before they announced they were going to be account bound and when everything shot up by like five times the amount, so, and they were the offhand, so I made like 60 gold off of them, so. But yeah, so, hey, basically what I'm saying is, hey, Jim Moore.
I'd like to say that I only got one precursor out of the forge, is the Hunter, and I bought all of mine, so feel bad for me, guys.
Oh wow, I feel bad in chat. They bought the Ghastly Grinning Shield for 700 gold a few weeks ago. Went down to 200, but it went back to at least 400. So at least it's not as
300
bad.
Gold, though. That's
yeah,
that's
it's still a lot,
steep.
But if it would have stayed at 2, that would hurt so much more. So yeah. It's a deep price cut, but it's not as deep as it was. So oh, cool. Wait, you bought two. Oh, you bought two. I thought you meant that, and you had three. I was like,
that's
hey, that
600.
Leaves one. Yeah. Anyway, I'm trying to take from chat for some reason. Anyway, so I think what was also interesting in the patch, like we said before from the quote, was this was part of a bigger update to the Mystic Forge. What is this bigger update? Possibly I was thinking, do you think they will extend this to other skins eventually? Like maybe armor, back pieces that
I hope they
that you can only get in Living World Season 1.
Like the tribal stuff? Like anything that I would love to see, even though you'd have to craft a shit ton of back pieces, but the Molten Jetpack. I like that skin. I have literally I have to spend 3,000 gold to get one at this point. So,
I like how Age is saying that, like 3,000.
So,
like if they're sitting at 3,000 gold, that was kind of what the Grinning Shield was. I mean,
yeah, and that jetpack is very exclusive. Yeah. I mean,
I don't comprehend the prestige thing behind stuff that it was just literally you were there for it.
Yeah, that's the prestige. You're there for it. You got it.
I saw things, man. I saw things. You think you're living through it with the fractals? No, man. I saw it. I was there for the pain. I built signs, man. I built the signs.
But for stuff that requires like skill to get, I get that. Like the legendary armor when it finally comes out. That takes getting a raid group together, going and doing shit. Yeah. Like, getting shit done. If you literally just had to be there, like, just be present for something to release,
mm-hmm.
that I don't really comprehend the prestige argument for. Well, also, they have just flat-out stated they want to bring that content back in the instanced style that the story journal brings. So,
I don't know.
It's gonna be unprestiged at some point.
I think prestige and
Guild Wars 2 means... to do it. Like, that's...
Yeah.
Right,
it's definitely one of those easier said than done things.
Prestige and Guild Wars 2 is more like, I get to have this exclusively. Me and a few other people have this exclusively for a good amount of time so that we could flaunt our stuff, you know? That's the prestige of that. That's what I feel like prestige and Guild Wars 2 is.
And I like how you're saying I didn't do anything, just being there. Hey, if I didn't put up those signs, those refugees in Wayfarer Foothills would still be walking around. They would have probably walked into Frostgorge. I saved lives, sir. I saved lives.
It's true. I mean, there's... What's like, really exclusive that you can't really get anymore?
You still get the monocle from... Because I think that was kind of like the backpack.
Holographic, well, yeah, but so shattered holographic... Can you still get the
tentacle backpack? I think is
tentacle exclusive. Backpack. You could buy that from a little vendor.
Can you get the quaddle wings?
I think so. I'm not sure.
I honestly kind of wish the quaddle wings would be remodeled, kind of like the bat wings are.
You keep saying this.
Well, it's just all the shattered wings, both of the holographic wings and the Takata wings seem kind of dinky. Compared to the bat wings, it just seems like a much better scale for them, and they would look better at that scale.
Yeah.
So that's more what I mean, is that I want them to be as big as the bat wings.
Yeah. But the only thing I can think of is a molten jetpack, tribal armor, and the destroyer scythe. That's about it.
Well, funny you mentioned the destroyer side, because I was about to say, all this cool stuff returning does come with a little bit of bad news. Because a lot of people were like, whoa, you know, all this stuff's coming. Is this a way to get the PvP destroyer side? Which, if you don't know, the destroyer weapons, there is a weapon, I think it's a staff. That looks like a scythe. It almost kind of looks like a destroyer, like tentacle thing. But people have asked... And they have gotten back to him. And unfortunately, only one person has ever gotten the PvP Destroyer Scythe. And I know people's spirits are raising. And it's a GM. Apparently, they spawned it in, and it's only on a GM. And this is why I think they said when they made the transition to the wardrobe system, it read everybody's stuff, and it put it in there.
Oh.
So there is no way to get it.
Right now,
they didn't say in the post that there's a plan on them implementing it, but as it stands right now, there is no way to get the destroyer scythe. Or at least that's what they want you to think, right?
We'll see. We shall see. I do want the tribal armor back because there's one piece that I want for Necro.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, I was definitely sad to hear that, but unfortunately, at least it puts people's minds at ease.
Yeah.
Hopefully. But, hopefully people don't fight over that. And speaking of fighting, let's jump into PvP and all the fun stuff that goes with that. Basically, pro leagues are going on. The pro league I know Age will be able to explain this a lot better, but I think it was, April 18th? Was mm-hmm. one of the matches between Car Crash and Civilized Gentleman, correct?
Yeah.
And there was supposedly an issue, and they have actually given word, Josh Davis, who associate global brand manager, he actually came down and said that I think the official thing is Car Crash had an ineligible player versus the Civilized Gentleman on April 18th. The player, Sam, was not playing on the account during the match, but it was Vermillion's Frostball. So, if you don't know, This is actually a violation of the ESL Guild Wars 2 Pro League rulebook and also the Guild Wars 2 user agreement. So, are you able to shed a little bit more light on that, or is that very much the...
That's pretty much the gist of it. So basically, Frostbolt was on Sam's account playing as Sam in the match versus Civilized Gentleman, and the arena actually caught on to that. And so, since it was a violation of both like Pro League and Guild Wars 2 user agreement, there were penalties involved. So, I believe it was Car Crash, the entire roster of Car Crash that were playing on that day, and Frostball were banned from Arenet-sponsored tournaments for the rest of the season. And I think they'll revisit their eligibility after that period's over. Which I think they'll be allowed to come back in. But yeah, that's a strong ruling. It's one of the first really strong rulings that I've seen.
Yeah, and which is good that they're showing that it's like, no, we're not messing around. This isn't like, yeah, follow the rules. So, you know, definitely kudos to ArenaNet and cracking down on it. I know a lot of people were actually saying that this wasn't enough. Like, they should have just, like, because, like you said, they are banned from ArenaNet-sponsored events effective April 27th through the end of the 2016 season, and people said that that wasn't enough. I'm curious, what do you guys think? Especially since this was a first infraction type thing.
It's April. That's 8 months worth of stuff. That's fine.
Well, remember, it just says they're banned from ArenaNet-sponsored competitive events. So it sounds like they can still play the game.
Yeah.
Which is very nice, because they even did say it was against Guild Wars 2's user agreement. So it could have been worse, but yeah, definitely. But,
yeah, now they're not making money.
They lose the chance to actually compete for cash and prestige and all that stuff.
But like, it's they're not really getting cash out of just playing the game, yeah. Unless they work for PvP Bank or something, or PvP Bank is one of their sponsors. But yeah, that's 8 months of stuff that they can't do.
Mm-hmm.
They can lose sponsors
if they have
them, but it's just it's
yeah, definitely for a first,
it's a big
a
deal.
First time event, because I think a lot of people were like they should be banned forever, but
that escalated quickly.
Also, all the matchups between weeks 1 and week 7 are 2-0 in favor of teams that were supposed to fight Car Crash.
So yeah,
that's kind of important to say.
I'm surprised they didn't just set it up as a bye. It just seems odd to me. Like, why would you just give them the wins?
Well,
I don't know how
I don't know if they can completely change their roster. For sure, Dill, it's not just Sam and Frostball only, because apparently on the forum post it says Frostball and all Car Crash members that played on April 18th will be banned from Arenet-sponsored competitive events. So,
Because in that situation, I would imagine they'd have to have some kind of knowledge that, you know, their teammate isn't their teammate. I mean, I don't know. This is just me.
They're on voice comms.
But, you know, I can't guarantee any of that, but I would imagine, yeah, they would be using some voice communication, because if they're not, they're playing at a whole different PvP level, then they're going old school. We ain't talking telepathy to one another. We're good.
Yeah, they have telepathy going for them.
Whoa.
Steep.
And I don't know what... I mean, I was about to read a quote from Chris Cleary, who's the game security lead, but man, if they got telepathy, I don't know if he can catch them. But for the people that don't have telepathy, just beware. Account sharing comes with certain risks. Normally, they don't take action against it unless one of the parties was doing bad things. But doing it during a tournament is a bad idea. And Chris clearly says, I'll make something very clear. When you share your account, we know. You can try to hide it, but we know, and we will be watching. So that's definitely a good thing for future competitors. And I'm glad it kind of happened earlier rather than down the road. Like, so
yeah,
you know, it sets precedent that, yeah, they're going to crack down.
And Neko, I have no idea why he played Recurrent. Maybe it's just like...
Yeah.
I have no idea why he did it.
Yeah, chat's asking why would he do that if that risk is there, which, yeah, that really lies with, you know, Sam and Frostball and if the rest of the Car Crash team knew, like, the reason why. But, yeah, I don't think anybody has actually came out and said one reason or another, so... But yeah, overall, do you guys think this is a more than fair punishment for?
I think it accomplishes two things. So one, it proves that they're going to be just and fair about how they're going to set rules, and they're going to be very strict about it. And two, it sets up a precedence for people so that, like, hey, we're going to be strict about these things. Don't do it. Don't do it. So.
Well, I mean, now that we know you can't get someone else to play your account for you, we got the next best thing. SPVP class tier list, thanks to Academy Gaming, they actually went out and pulled more than 10 pro league players at random from both NA and EU regions and kind of found the average of all of them. Basically, it looks like, and this is how they, if you're familiar with, I think, some fighting games and stuff, you have the S tier, A tier, B tier, C tier, and D tier.
All the way to F, pretty much, I think.
Yeah. But yeah, it seems like, should we work from the bottom up, or should we show the top quality ones first?
I kind of feel bad for the bottom of it, but...
Let's start from the bottom up.
You would. the D tier... they didn't have an F tier in this one, but the D tier was Guardian. But it did receive an F tier vote. But like we said, it averaged out, and they weren't F, they were D. Yay!
Now, does that mean that it's they're missing out on damage, or is it?
It's, well,
I'm not incredibly familiar with how like the ranking system goes, but I know Guardian has a lot of defenses and a lot of CC and utility, so I would assume that it would have to be lacking on damage for it to get hit that hard.
No, well. So all these pro players voted on this and said that out of all these things, the average of them said that Guardian was the worst out of all 9 professions. And I think the reason being is that it's just, if you're not getting like horribly bursted out and you're not squishy, it's fairly easy to fight a Guardian if you know what you're doing. I think that's the only way.
And if you don't get Dragon Hunter F1 pulled into the air.
You've got to stop bringing these up, man. This is bad memories for me.
Look, I was confused when I saw that on your stream. For people who don't know, apparently there is a bug where if you're standing against a wall or if you're standing a level, like, on a different level?
If you're standing a different level, yeah.
Okay.
And a Guardian pulls you, you will get hit into the wall, and you will get... It's really easy to do on Fofire, but you get pulled into the wall, and then you get shot up into the air, and you actually come down, but you're actually going to take fall damage. So you actually took damage while going up in the air. You might be at half health, you come back down, but since you take fall damage...
Wait, what was that in PvP?
In PvP,
The Guardian, you said faux fire? Okay, faux fire. I just want to make sure it's gone for good.
I'll make sure it's gone for good, damn it. That's so broken. Anyway, but yeah, I think it's fairly easy to fight a Guardian if you know what you're doing. Guardian's kind of like an easy mode against opponents who don't know what to do against it. For example, if you see Guardian on point, you don't really go on point because they probably have traps on there. Or you dodge in and out so that the traps are triggered.
And I do agree with chat. Sounds like a feature, not a bug.
Sounds like a feature.
But shall we move on to the C tier? So it looks like for C tier, we have the Necromancer and the Warrior. I remember we were talking. I thought Warrior got like a lot of like Condi love, like it was super awesome.
I was actually a little surprised by this, but I think the Necromancer got hit with the chills.
Yeah, in the spring quarterly update, they really nerfed chill across the board, and then I think further in the Necromancer line itself.
The reason why Necromancer is so good is just because you have a lot of damage, and you have essentially two life bars. But if you know how to play around that, you can pretty much win a fight. With Warrior, everyone knows the Sarah Warrior. Warrior was just bad sustain-wise, but their damage is always pretty decent. And I think I haven't tried it yet, but they recently got a buff to Adrenal Health, I think it was, and I think a few other things that made it a little bit more viable. So I think that's why it's just above Guardian in this case. Necromancer, I think, went down because of the hits to chill, hits to infuse terror. So it's less survivability, I think it has. But it's still pretty good, in my opinion. It's still pretty strong.
Okay, well, let's take a look at the B tier. So we are looking at, for kind of the third best ones to go after, Engineer and Thief. I mean, Thief.
You're a B-tier age.
Yeah.
Mm.
What are you, B-squad? What's up with that, man?
I think that's actually a good range for it to be in. Thief has more damage.
It sounds like it won't get nerfed. You're in the safe spot.
Thief keeps getting more damage. That's okay, I guess. But I think Arena wants Thief to be like, you go into a fight for 5 seconds, do damage, and then you get out. I think that's what they want with Thief right now. And I think it's doing its job right now. I was watching Guild Wars 2 MSI from Academy Gaming earlier, and I saw Toker and Sinjara Thief, and they were doing pretty good work. They're getting those. They're pretty much the decapping plus one rolls, but they're pretty strong at the plus one-ing part now. So I think that's why it maybe up a tier.
You hop into a fight, you do a bunch of burst damage, and turn the fight into your team's favor, and then you leave.
Pretty much. Yeah. For Engineer, the sustain got hit, but still pretty decent from what I've seen. I've watched Chase stream Engineer still, and he's still pretty good on it. It looks pretty good overall still. It's just like you got hit with the sustain quite a bit. So I still think it's still pretty viable overall.
Awesome. I mean, yeah. I don't know. You're in the third tier. I don't think I can let you in my PvP group. I run on a pretty high level. I need only S and A's because I need them to carry me.
The average was B. So that means a few people have chosen S or A tier. So, just saying.
Well, let's look at A tier. And under A, we got Elementalist and Ranger.
Yeah, these are your
sustain. Was it all that Scepter love for Elementalist? Are they amazing? With Scepter?
I will admit, Scepter does feel a hell of a lot better to use. One of the biggest changes was the fire auto attack does not feel slow as hell anymore. They cut the cast time by 0.2 seconds and the aftercast by 0.38. So that's almost three-quarters of a second shaved off of... It's like two-thirds of a second shaved off of your casting animation cycle. So Scepter is okay for burst. I think it needs some more help otherwise. But I
still think it's bad.
I'm not disagreeing with that. I'm not. Yeah. But like, I know that if you go fire and then Dragon's Tooth Phoenix, it's a hell of a lot of burst damage. But Scepter is not fantastic for sustained, even though air, like with the auto attack, you can cast the 2 and 3 while channeling stuff. You've got a spike damage and a blind on that, and they're on relatively low cooldowns. And then the water has a heal. It's got a relatively low cooldown AoE Vuln effect. So, you know, you're spamming conditions on people. Earth feels odd for Scepter, so I can kind of see why Scepter is still bad. But I think a lot of the other... Just there were a lot of, in general, here is some damage for Elementalist in the April patch.
Okay. So, yeah, as Elementalist and Ranger are just the sustainy types, and I feel like they're just still needed as of right now. So I can see why they're A tier. That's pretty much the reasoning, I guess.
Okay. And if you've been keeping track, you already know, but S tier, so top of the charts, are the Mesmer and Revenant.
Yeah.
So,
if you're on a probe team, you must have one of each. Like, you need at least... You need a Mesmer, and you need at least one Revenant, I feel like. Otherwise, I think you're doing it wrong. Because Revenant got hit, like, a little bit, but it's still pretty good. It's pretty damn good overall. Power Arcondi. Mesmer is just absurdly good, and Portal is exceptionally good right now. And the damage Mesmer can bring out is exceptional as well. And I honestly would not understand why you would not bring a Mesmer. Because, right there, like, Mesmer received 100% of S-tier votes. Like, that counts for something.
Mm-hmm.
Muted. Mesmers are kind of like a quintessential PvP class. They have a lot of blocks, counters, stuff that triggers when people attack you. Hell, dueling, the entire trait line feels like it's centered on dealing with other people.
Yeah, and MOA. And they have MOA, they're great at dueling. They're just really good right now.
It's actually, like, Mesmers being, you know, illusionists and all that, is actually the funny thing that makes them worse at PvE. Because computers can see through that shit. Players can't. I can't tell you the number of times I've thrown attacks at clones in WDub because you lose track of shit. So, and that, you know, Mesmers can stand still and just cast their auto attack and you think it's a clone. So,
yeah. And the beauty is Continuum Shift, where you use that and you have something like MOA or Time Warp and you can cast that twice. That's pretty awesome. Or once and have a lower cooldown.
And then I think you just triggered Netco in chat because he was the guy who said ban everybody that casts MOA.
Yeah.
They cast MOA twice.
I seriously hate that. I hate that so much when I get MOA'd and I'm like, okay, I can go MOA'd. No! And then, yeah.
Can you not break out of that?
I don't think it replaces all your skills, I thought.
It's instacast, and you are literally have MO abilities.
Yeah.
Usually I just fight. I just fight. I don't care. I'm going in.
That's a good point. Pay attention to the Signet passives, and you'll know. I'll have to remember that next time, because I am one of those people that will be like, haha, I'm going to kill you, and they disappear into a fluttery butterflies. I'm like, nah, son of a...
Unless, of course, they do what Riot Games did with clones in League of Legends, where they have fake buffs on them.
No.
Please don't do that. That's hard enough to find mesmerists as it is. And
during the edit, Quad do a bleep.
Quad has a good point. I don't really pay attention to... I usually just don't fight mesmers. I just leave. Or I AoE cleave. Those are one, two things, and then I just find which one is not taking more damage, and then I just go for that one. Or I just know which one's the right mesmer.
But as we were going through the list, we kind of hit upon them here and there, and we talked about it last week with the quarterly update. Now that time has passed, and it seems like everything has kind of, the dust has settled for the changes, how do you guys feel the professions are balance-wise?
I don't feel terribly different playing my Elementalist or my Guardian, because those are the two classes that I play the most. I don't feel like there was a lot of heavy mechanics changes, just a lot of numbers changes. So I'm not terribly, like, I'm not really hit with that. But then again, I also don't play much PvP.
I will say, now that we're kind of talking about just balances in general, you can also extend this to PvE, because and Worthy World. And because I know PvE engineers kind of got a whooping.
Oh, yeah, Slickshoes. Forgot about that.
Technically, no, that's the same in PvP. Like, that's still a big nerf to engineers, period, the end.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, Slickshoes kind of got... I don't know if people... I don't think people run Slickshoes anymore because of that in PvP.
For people who don't know, Slickshoes for engineers can only knock down once per skill cast. So if you get knocked down and you get back up again, they're never going to keep you down.
Yeah, if I get knocked down, but I get up again.
For it before you could, Deo. I'm sorry.
I don't think engineers bring Slickshoes anymore. I don't think it's worth it anymore.
Yeah. It's just I've had an experience with it because it was was attacking an engineer that was on point, and it's Slickshoes knocked me down, and he set up the big old bomb, the tool belt skill from the bomb kit, which is a massive launch. So while I'm flat on my face, thanks to Slickshoes, the timer on that is ticking, and then I get back up. I can't dodge roll because I'm in the stand-up animation, and then I just get kind of launched away from the point. And it's just, engineers still have a lot of solid point control. So.
Yeah. And I have to, for the most part, agree with what Chad's saying. Like, didn't feel like much change. Some skills, nerf. But, yeah, for the most part, the meta, like, I know for me, the meta for my Necro, Revenant, like, that build pretty much changed. Pretty much stayed the same. There are some situations, like you said, engineers just aren't bringing Slickshoes anymore. Were there any other ones that kind of really got hit hard that they're just not bringing a skill anymore?
I don't think so. I think it was just Slickshoes. I don't know if engineers are running it. I have to check Meta Battle later, but yeah. Like to see. But I don't think it's... Well, maybe for the tools kit break it might be good, but I don't know. I do agree that not much of the meta has changed. I will say, though, that Thief and Warrior are looking a lot better for play, but we shall see how that goes.
Didn't you say you saw a Warrior while you were watching Thief?
I did see a Warrior, but I don't know how it's going to turn out because an issue happened with the stream that I won't talk about here. But an issue happened with the stream I was watching, and they had to do it offline. So I will not be able to find out how that Warrior does. And I'm kind of sad.
Well, any other thoughts of the professions and how they balanced out after the quarterly update?
Because,
I think, like we said, it didn't... There wasn't that many big swings within all of them, but...
Yeah.
Except for a couple.
Some things were warranted, some things weren't, but
make Guardian great again.
Yeah, well.
And even still, I mean, that's one of those things where it's like the shades of difference between these tiers could still be relatively small.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just there is marked steps. They could be tiny, but there are definite differences. So yeah. There's that.
Well, let's look at some gem store stuff. Because if you're on the top of the... If you're in S tier, you gotta look like you're in S tier. And I know what can make you look like you're in S tier. Some chaos gloves. And thanks to Dolphy for checking things out in the gem store and making sure it looks good so you don't have to spend the money unless you want to. So you can get these chaos gloves for 500 gems. They are dyeable, and they are an armor piece. And when you unlock it, you get the light, medium, and heavy. And as you can see, it's going through the two different colors on multiple races. And so you can see how they dye. So
I know a lot of people were worried that you weren't going to be able to dye them.
Well, I think the worry came from the chaos weapons weren't, but...
Right.
I mean, but those are weapons are dyeable, weapons, unfortunately.
Yeah. I am super... I want these, because I usually buy all the Guild Wars 1 prestige, like the, not prestige, but nostalgic
things. Trust me.
Things.
They were prestigious in Guild Wars 1. Like,
yeah, they were prestigious.
You had to use a lot of Ectos, which
yeah.
are a lot more of a pain to get than Ectos in Guild Wars 2. But yeah, for people that don't know, the reason so many people are possibly swooning over these, the Chaos Gloves were from a vendor in Guild Wars 1, and I think he had to trade, at least a stack of Ectos, it's a lot harder to get than what the Ectos are now. But it basically gave you those gloves to use on your character. So as simple as that, it was just a lot of material, because basically Ectos in Guild Wars 1 were used as a currency after you were going past the currency limit. So, you know, people would be like, oh, this is worth, you know, 20 Ectos or... But... So... Yeah, that.
Can one of you guys buy them for me?
No. How much are they again?
500 gems.
Maybe I could buy them for you.
Ooh. Yeah.
There you go.
Can you? Buy I need to change copies? All my American money back to Canadian money, so in order to buy them.
If you are interested in those, if you want to relive the glory days of Guild Wars 1 and Guild Wars 2, definitely pick them up. Or if you want a small taste of Guild Wars 1, then definitely pick them up. This probably pertains to the people here live, and this is why it's so important to show up live, because I think by the time this goes on YouTube on Sunday, these sales will have ended. But the monk's outfit, which is... A lot of these items are 10% off. The monk's outfit you can get for 630 gems. The Raymond of the Lich outfit you can get for, once again, 630 gems. The Prime Evil Heavy Armor skin is 10% off for 450 gems. The Crichton Medium Armor skin is also for 450 gems. You can see right there. The Profane Light Armor skin is also for 450 gems. And also... What doesn't really the Black Wings glider combo, which is also a back piece and also a glider skin for 700 gems. And also in there you can get the Royal Terrorist Pass came back, and I think that's 1,000 gems. And the Home Portal Stone, which is 25% off for 675 gems. And that is ending, I believe, noon Eastern on Sunday. So definitely, if you want any of those, go and pick them up. So, are you guys possibly gonna pick any of these up at the 10% discount?
I have Monk, I have Prime Veil, I have Crichton.
You're not gonna get the Profane?
Hell no.
I actually have the Profane.
That's, Ugh, that.
Well, granted, the reason I have it was I think when they made the update thing and they gave everybody another hero box, it's the only one I didn't have, so I got it for.
Oh, okay, that's fine. I didn't get it. Eventually. The profane light armor is just like. It's like that bad guy in Power Rangers outfit. I think that's the best way to put it.
Yeah.
And those are just on the humans, so if you want to check them out on the other characters,
it doesn't look any better.
I think it looks a little bit better on. I forget what.
It's the shoulders.
I think it is the shoulders.
Yeah.
Like, it's too much. Like, it's World of Warcraft shoulders. They're too freaking
out there.
Stupidly massive.
I don't think they're even massive. I just think they're just too out there. You know?
Primeval is good, though. I really do like the Primeval. I already have that, but I might buy the Chaos Gloves. Who knows? Maybe I'll buy an Age pair, too.
I like how I'm just
one of the things that I have heard brought up, though, is that it clips on the inside forearm of a char.
Oh, the Chaos Gloves?
Yeah. It clips just slightly.
Oh, wow, clipping on a char?
That's fine.
Yeah, let's clipping on a char. Who would have guessed?
Definitely if you want to pick these up, like I said, if you're here live, go check it out. If you're watching this on YouTube, I'm pretty sure it's already gone, especially by the time you probably get to this if you're waiting, if you're watching all the way through. But definitely, I might have calculated wrong. Go check. But yeah, it does end, I'm pretty sure, Sunday at noon Eastern. So, but hey, you're now making your characters look good. Now you got to make yourself look good and your room. More stuff from IM8-Bit has hit the stores. Oh, I didn't want to tell you, man, but you know, you need some pins and some stickers.
Oh, I do.
As you can see here, for $10 each, you can either get the Quaggan pin, which you just saw, the Dermot Priory one, the Vigil pin, or the Order of Whispers pin. So,
that's kind of neat.
Yeah, if you are an intelligent person, you will pick up the Order of Whispers pin, because that is the only order you should be joining. Let you join the other ones just so you can get the achievement and the shiny little, you know, banners on your login page. But, you know, all your other characters should be in the Order of Whispers.
I don't know. I might just end up getting... I need to get the Heart of Thorns LP.
Yes, just, that is still up there, too.
Me too.
Because we talked about it awesome.
on the show last, like, way back when it first came out. But
yeah.
Hey, are they doing anything else besides pins?
Yes, they actually have some stickers you can also get for $10 each, and they are the Profession Sticker Pack, which you can see there, and also the Elite Specialization Sticker Pack, which you can see right there. So, you know, if you want to show you're a Guardian, but if you want to show you're a Dragon Hunter, you can't get just the Guardian stickers. But like I said, 10 bucks a pop for each set, so don't think it's per sticker, because that would be bad.
I still dislike I'm a shoe for my elite spec.
You want the icon that you get for your vault?
Yeah,
targeting, don't you?
I tweeted out
I'm a shoe.
They put a decal for all the for what profession you're running, and for staff vaults. They had an awesome decal. I'm like, why can't this be the Daredevil one? I think it's because just it clashes with Tempest.
But like I said, you know, you could use this to outfit yourself. But like I said, you got to make your room look nice as well. So they have put in IM8-Bit a Super Adventure Box crew poster, which you can see there. It is 36 inches by 12. And it is $25, so... Hey, you said you wanted to see how you could what you could do with your American money you still had left over. There you go.
As he throws it at the screen.
Gary.
I mean, that looks awesome, but if you're a fan of like some of the loading screens, like concept art and stuff, because some of that stuff is beautiful. Actually, all of the stuff is. But you know the loading screen for Dragonstand? I think we've all seen it either when we are dying from the time running out because we're trying to get into the meta event. But you can actually pick it up for your own wall. Ooh. Imagine you walking into your room, you feel like you're loading into Dragonstand. That's hopefully you don't die. But it is $65 and it is 30 inches by 20 inches. And you can see the art for that right there. So would you guys be willing to pick any of that stuff up
or do you like
that they're doing this kind of stuff? I mean,
yeah, no, that's their artwork. Their loading screen artwork is fantastic. So yeah, them putting out stuff like this, that's perfect. I would kind of hope that they end up doing that for a lot of their other artwork too. So
yeah.
Just a side note for this. I know some Guild Wars 2 content creators have links, so you can get like 15% off, I think, for stuff like this.
Nice.
So if you want to support your favorite content creators, check if they have one of these links.
I was not aware that they had like discounts on IM8bit for that. So yeah, definitely check them out.
I know for a fact that Bog does.
Okay, yeah, I was gonna actually say, you know, if you're watching, for people in chat, if you know someone that does, and throw their information up there just so people can link to it in here, and same to YouTube. If you know someone that, one of the YouTubers that does, you know, throw it in the comments just so that way people can find it and, you know, get a discount and get some cool art or, you know, make their room look like Dragonstand itself. Though, granted, would not want to wake up to that. But, yeah, so, good to know. I was not even aware of that, so. Always a good thing. Support, you know, content creators. And that's all we have news. That's all the news we have for this week. So, Jim, where can you be found?
I'm found on Twitter, at MalthanusMMO.
And Age, where can you be found?
Oh, Twitch, Twitter, and YouTube, at AgeNightRed. I'm usually streaming Guild Wars 2, if not League of Legends. And I put out a blog post about the patch, so I'll try to do that next week.
And you can find me at simply_Deo on Twitch and Twitter. And you can find us, if you're tuning in live at the very end, this will go up on our YouTube channel. Just search Talking Skrit. We're usually the first one that pops up. And that goes up on YouTube every Sunday at noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific. And if you are watching on YouTube, you know, like I said, you might have missed some of those gem store sales, so you definitely got to tune in live sometimes. You can do that on Saturdays at twitch.tv/talkingskrit. And we go live every Saturday at 4 p.m. Eastern, 1 p.m. Pacific. And as always, we will see you in the game. Good night, everybody.